Hello, welcome back to the Weekly Comet. I'm Jonathan McHugh.
And I am Tamara Conniff. Today we have legendary Yes prog rocker and award-winning film composer Trevor Rabin here with us to talk about his latest projects, including his first solo album in 2 decades,
wow. Jacaranda. Been a long time, Mr. Rabin.
And it's an amazing album.
But every week we try to have amazing live music, and this week is no different. And this week we're going to give you the rockers the Golden Ghost. So, gentlemen, rock it.
Woo!
Hello, internets. Hello, studio. We're the Golden Ghosts, and this is a love song. Baby, I'm so tired of you fooling around. You know you screw me up. Yeah, you screw me down. Let me tell you something. You're gonna miss me when I'm not around. You better watch your step. You better step in line. I've either loved to see. I'm burning cocoa sweat at every evening break. Another tiny day. But you ain't fooling me none now, honey, dog. Don't you forget.
Them Golden Ghosts.
Amazing. Riley Braid, the frontman lead singer, is going to join us on the couch later. For everyone out there watching, just a little bit of trivia. Riley's actually 6'7", so we had to adjust the cameras to get his full fantastic lanky frame. So,
that's
yes.
By the way, that's the largest rock
Some
guy
special,
we've had on the show.
Like, literally, the tallest rock god we've had on the show, right?
Yeah. So far. We're going to try to get Yao Ming, who plays a little bit of Chinese flute. He'll be in next time.
That's right. We'll have a list.
He's 7-1. But until then, Riley has broken the record. Congratulations, Riley. All right. Guess what time
now
it is.
It's time for us, the Comet News.
Yeah, I love that segment.
You know, I'm kind of tired of talking about
You're
it.
You're going to do it again,
I know,
you?
I got to do it again.
But, you know, this is what happens when you get a hit record.
Oh,
you
know, and I'm so sick of the song. Anyway, Gautier.
But the remixes, though, are cool.
Yeah, the remixes are really cool. Gautier, somebody I used to know, is still number one.
Wait, you used to know him?
No, I didn't. I know. Did you?
Oh, no, the song.
Funny.
Oh, yeah,
funny.
Right. My bad,
Boom.
Where's the drum roll?
Yeah. On the Ultimate Chart, Interesting enough, Tony Luca did not win The Voice, but his take on 99 Problems debuted at number 14.
The Jay-Z song?
Yeah.
Yeah, and a Biatch Ain't One. That's what it.
Which I think is interesting.
Yeah.
So, that's
what about this Philip Phillips kid? He won the American Idol, making it 5 male winners in a row.
You know why that is?
Chicks used to dominate that show.
You know why that is?
Why?
Because boys don't vote.
Right.
The girls are voting for like the guy they think is hot.
Unfortunately, I have not seen the show once this year.
It's
the first time ever. I've not watched my friend Randy on the show, and I'm sorry for that.
And what's happened to the past 5 male winners?
Somebody's got to have some hits, don't they?
No, nobody.
No hits?
No hits.
It's a problem. You got to have hits.
No hits.
Deep sigh. That was good. That was a collective deep sigh. We're getting tired of talking about people dying. But
I know.
And it's human nature. People are born. Rock stars are born every day. And rock stars die.
It's been every week.
Yeah, but it happens. People are getting old.
Anyway.
Cancer. Just doesn't care how big a star you are. Robin Gibb. Another third BG to die, is that correct? Or the third Gibb brother?
No, he is one of four Gibb brothers.
No, but the third Gibb brother to die.
He is the third Gibb brother to die.
There's one surviving Gibb brother. And we send out our condolences to that surviving Gibb brother.
Literally, I can say that like the Bee Gees have been like the soundtrack of so much of my life and my dance-a-thons.
Were you back in big in the disco era, back in the Saturday Night Fever? Were you out there doing your thing?
Well, it was a little bit before.
You were young? You couldn't sneak into Studio 54?
If I could have, I would have. But I tend to listen to all kinds of music, and so I was definitely really into the Bee Gees. I've been blessed enough to spend time with Robin,
wow,
who was truly like an amazingly generous and kind person. So please
all right,
let us
let's
not
hopefully
report
next week,
any
nobody
more
dies.
Dead people. No dead people.
God bless.
You took me to a show.
I did. It was your birthday. I promised I'd take you out. I showed up a little late, but I did write the check for dinner.
You did.
And,
I ate egg rolls.
This band, Gaslight Anthem.
Amazing.
Bruce Springsteen loves him. Tamara Conniff loves him. I love them. Watch out for them.
Yeah, they truly, I didn't know that Bruce loved them, and I kind of came to the show blind. And when I was watching them perform, my first thought was like, oh, and I would never say this because I love Bruce Springsteen.
Right.
I was like, wow, that's like a young Bruce.
Right.
Really kind of got that all-American vibe. So they're definitely a band to watch.
Yeah.
And next up.
We got a big star in the
big
house.
Big star in the house.
This show is getting big. We got big people coming in. I mean, big like tall and big like 40 films.
We're just getting large.
And big like 40 films,
we're
like
just
yes, big.
Large in general. But first, check out this clip, and then Trevor Rabin is going to join us on the couch.
Oh,
welcome to the show, Trevor.
Thank you.
It has been 2 decades between solo albums for you. This is your new album, Jacaranda. It is out right now. It is absolutely stunning. We just saw a clip of it. Tell us why 2 decades between solo records.
Once I'd left Yes, I was concentrating on film. I started doing film in about 95, and having done so many movies, I just didn't have the time and really wasn't that inspired to do another album. But eventually, once I started, I slowly got into it.
And you sort of did this on the side while doing, you know, little films like Armageddon and National Treasure and mega Jerry Bruckheimer blockbusters.
Yeah, but in all honesty, because of that, last year I pretty much grabbed last year, and I did, to the distress of my agents, I needed a couple of things in the movie stuff and finished the album.
Yeah, that probably didn't go over too well.
No.
I want to be alone. I'd like to go make a record. I got Bruckheimer on the phone. He's got a lot of money for you. You sure you want to think about that?
Yeah. Actually, quite often, if there's a movie that I really don't want to do, they'll call me back and say, how much don't you want to do it?
That's a good question.
I land up doing it.
That's funny.
You talk about that. So you've done over 40 films, including, obviously, we talked about some of the biggest, you know, Bruckheimer being one of the biggest prolific producers,
right.
Which is an amazing career unto itself. Then you had this amazing career with Yes. And talk about that transition of how you did it and what do you think it takes for an artist to make it as a composer, to swap careers, if you will.
Well, a lot of it was I was fortunate enough to be in the right place at the right time. I was, after doing the Yes tour, I got to get used to this.
That's
thing.
Okay.
It's back okay. You can look at them. You can look at us.
Okay. I just feel rude if I'm not looking at you.
It's against all social graces here at the Comet.
It's the whole internet thing.
Right. Well, I went to a restaurant in L.A. and my wife and I went there to eat, and the maitre d' came up to me and said, oh, Steven Seagal owns the studio, and the restaurant. Yeah, studio, restaurant, it's all.
Wow,
Steven Seagal, yeah. And he said he really wants some guitar lessons. So I thought, well, I want to get into film, so maybe I'll talk to him. And,
wow,
you know,
that's
and
funny.
I went and I sat at his place for a couple of hours, and we went through a couple of things. I remember I taught him how to play Red House by Hendrix and
wow.
a couple of other things. And
first, can I say balls to ask you to teach him guitar?
His assistant asked me.
That's just insane. I mean, you're one of the like most amazing guitar players. Be like, oh yeah, do you mind giving me lessons? Wow.
Well, I'm a terrible teacher, but I went and spent a couple of hours with him, and then he said, thank you, if there's anything I can do for you. And I said, well, I want to get into film scoring. He said, well, are you familiar with what? I said, well, yeah, I'm trained in classical music. I conduct, arrange, and can write. And then, obviously, I'm pretty familiar with rock and roll. So I think I'm okay with it, and technically I'm okay. So I thought he was going to give me a phone number of someone. Well, call him. He can help you. But he said, well, I've just finished a movie. Do you want to do it?
Wow.
So I said, yeah, of course.
Wow.
I didn't even think about it. I just said, yeah. And someone, I did that movie, and then someone came to the premiere from Bruckheimer's camp and liked the music. They didn't like the movie, but they liked the music.
That's amazing.
And thereafter, you know, I've done 13 Bruckheimer movies.
So kids at home, remember, if someone asks you to do something you don't necessarily want to do, it could lead to greater things.
It could lead to greater things.
And that's a fantastic story, actually.
That is actually a great story.
That's a wonderful Hollywood story.
I still can't get over the assistant asking the guitar lesson thing, but thank God you did it.
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't...
Thank God you're like, okay.
I didn't really know how serious I was about film. It was just a curiosity in the beginning.
And when you got the bug, that was it.
And once I got it, I just love it. You know?
Right.
And so on the album, your son, Your son Ryan plays on it with you. And Ryan is in one of your favorite.
Group Love, man. I didn't realize. I saw them at Coachella for the first time.
Oh, yeah.
And what I loved
about it. Did you go first or second week?
First.
Oh, I was there.
And what I loved about it was their performance. They were so genuinely happy to be there. Like they said, we've been coming to this thing for 9 years, and this is our first show here.
Wow.
And it was just like you felt that, like, you know, local guys make good.
Yeah.
And they have hits. They came up with a couple hits.
Yeah.
The songs just stand out and above and beyond, and the crowd singing every word.
Yeah.
I didn't even know your son was in the band. So which one is your son?
He's the drummer.
Okay.
He also co-writes the songs with him, and he's also the producer.
You must be so proud.
And, yeah, I mean, it was an amazing story with Group Love. My son Ryan went to, was it Crete? Crete. He went to Crete.
Greece. In Crete.
Yeah.
Okay.
And was kind of on holiday in a kind of artistic retreat. And met everyone in the band. He was there with his surfer buddy from Malibu, and they went there together, and they met up with these people, and he came home, and he said, I've been, because he went to USC for 4 years and did music there, and he said, I've met with these people, and there's really something here. We've written some stuff. Can the band stay at the house for a while? So I'm thinking a weekend or so.
Uh-oh.
3 months later, the album was finished.
Wait, are they all staying at your house the whole time?
But of course.
3 months.
You're a wonderful father and mother.
You can't say no.
Oh, it was great. And you know, the amazing thing about them is how genuine they are on stage. If you come to the house and hear them rehearsing, they enjoy it just as much. They really love their company. And what they do. Like,
was this the first time your son was played on a couple of tracks on Jacaranda, correct?
He played on two tracks.
On two tracks.
Yeah.
What was it like working? Is this the first time you guys had worked together?
Well, you know, no, we've worked together on other things, but the incredible thing was, you know, he's never played jazz, and some of this is fusion and peculiar time signatures, and we went in to do the track, and I thought, I'm going to sit down with him and explain what 7/8 is, because it's a very different way to play. And he was like, Dad, just play the track.
The typical kid thing.
Yeah, and it took two takes, and it was done. He just...
Yeah, they don't really want to hear it. They just said, yeah, I got this, don't worry about it.
Yeah, and he did, you know.
These Ravens are talented. That's
another great story. Go on vacation. You never know what happens.
You
never know who you meet.
Come home with a band, you know, and then hopefully your dad will put you up for 3 months.
Right. So one last thing I want to cover is your former partner in Yes, John Anderson.
Yes.
So, you know, one of the most amazing rock voices of all time.
Right.
And, you know, when I was working, I worked for Dino De Laurentiis back in the day in the film, and a woman that I worked with ended up going to work for Ron Howard at Imagine. And I don't know, you know the story. And then one day John Anderson came in for a meeting with her, and she says to me, yeah, I met John Anderson, he's this nice guy, and then I didn't see her for like 10 years, it disappeared.
Right.
And then I was like, what are you doing? She says, well, I married John Anderson, and I'm touring with John Anderson.
Never know who you're going to meet.
And, you know, they had this big house on the Pacific Palisades, right on the ocean. I don't know if you remember that house.
I remember the house.
And
they were in San Luis Obispo.
She's like, yeah, right, they moved up to a castle in San Luis Obispo. And she's like, yeah, he's my, you know, I'm his muse, and, you know, I travel around with him. And
can
I
you put that on a business card? I'm the muse. I want that on my business.
So, Jane Luttenberger, if you're out there, love you. Congratulations. It's been a great life for you.
Oh, my God.
She's great people, though.
They're great. John and I speak all the time.
Do you?
Yeah, in fact, the last film I did, he came over from San Luis Obispo, and he stayed at us for a week.
Really?
And I thought, well, I don't know what you're going to do. I'm just sitting with orchestra every day for a week. And he literally sat in the back with his eyes closed and just listened to the music.
Just loves
he was really
magic. He's a music. It goes all the way through.
Oh yeah,
they're such soulful people, you know.
Right.
So, do you ever think about just doing a gig with them, touring, going?
Actually, Rick Wakeman, John, and I have been talking about doing something together for the last three years. So, you know, schedule's just a real problem. But
Bruckheimer will give you a couple months off, won't he?
I don't care.
Please do it.
It was one of my favorite shows.
We
want
to do it.
And
Madison Square Garden, Yes in the Round, a long time ago. But it was great.
And promise to keep us posted. And thank you so much.
Thank you.
For coming on the show, and everybody,
Jacaranda. Pick up Jacaranda.
Jacaranda. Next up, Golden Ghost frontman Riley Bray is coming to join us on the couch. But first, check out this clip from the band's CD release party last month.